This webinar is designed for people that are new to doing their own analysis. It focuses on when and how to use crosstabs in market research. Just in case you aren't aware, the crosstab is the workhorse for all survey analysis. It's the most used and the most useful tool in the entire market research survey analysis toolbox. In this webinar, we're going to look at why we use crosstabs, what makes a good crosstab, the main ways of customizing crosstabs, how to use stat tests to save time when reading crosstabs, and resources for learning more. And we're going to kick off with what is a crosstab. We start with some data that we wish to understand. I've got some data on attitudes to Coca-Cola. In this data, we can see that 33% of people love Coke. But who are these people? Is this among everybody or just some segments? The way we answer that question at a simple way is we can just create a new table and filter it. So I'm going to filter it based on age, creating a filter of people aged 18 to 24 to see what their view is. So we can see here the 18 to 24s have a 50% love. So that's higher than the overall love. What about if we looked at a different age group? Maybe let's look at the 24s to 29s. I'll remove this filter and create a new one. Now, while that was a lot of fun, there's a faster way to do it. And the faster way is to create a crosstab. We start with a summary question that we're interested in, or a summary of a question we're interested in, and then we drag across the age variable and releasing it till it becomes columns of the table. The interpretation of this table is exactly the same as the ones before. Each column represents a different subgroup, and within each column we're seeing a summary for that subgroup. So here is the data for the 18 to 24s, here is the data for a 35 to 39 year old age group, and so on. The net column here is referring to the total. So this is the data which corresponds to this table shown here on the left. Sometimes we have a theory about a particular market. For example, we may believe that people who like Coke are very traditional and not open to new experiences. And we can test that directly by creating a table where we show the attitude to Coca-Cola. And then we cross it, to use the jargon, by the data showing openness to new experiences. And we look to see whether we have differences between the groups. And we can see here that we've got 34% of people who aren't open to new experiences that love Coca-Cola compared to 33%. That's a pretty marginal difference. So the theory that openness to new experiences predicts attitude to Coke is broken. In practice, though, theory testing like that is the exception rather than the rule. The rule in commercial research is you run lots and lots of crosstabs and you hunt through them all, just trying to extract some insight, something you hadn't thought about before. And I'll return to this later. We now move on to what makes a good crosstab. I'll start by showing you a bad crosstab. This is a bad crosstab. Why is it bad? Well, written down 8 little steps you can do to turn any crosstab into a good crosstab. This is really something that you can look at later. We're going to do it live, but you can refer back to this when we send you the recording of the webinar. So here's our original table. Each cell in this table has got 3 numbers. It's got a column percent, a row percent, and a count. It's a whole lot of data. Now, when I was learning research, this was routine. You wanted to have a whole lot of data, and that's because the lovely people in our data processing team, hi there Yaz, would take about a week to run any analysis that I requested. And consequently, I asked for every number I could possibly have computed. But now, it's much easier and faster. So rather than creating analyses with every number that you could possibly imagine, the smart play is to create analyses which only show the numbers that are interesting, because you can always easily get additional ones. And so the way we do this is we should generally only show the column percent when we create a crosstab. And so now we have greatly simplified this table. It's got a third as many numbers on it, which means it'll take a third as much time to interpret. The second of the rules is that you always want to show demographic data or other profiling data in the columns, not the rows. So let's switch them around. Now, the reason we do this is it means that we can interpret each column as being a summary in that subgroup. And so it's very easy to see differences between the subgroups, which is usually what we're most interested in when we're creating a crosstab. The next thing we want to do is just report whole numbers. So you can see at the moment here, it's got little decimal places. It's virtually never that a survey has got a large enough sample size that these decimals mean anything at all. And so we should just get rid of them. And even these percentage signs, they might look inoffensive, but they're taking up brain space. The more things that are on the screen, even if they're uninteresting, the harder it is for our brains to find patterns. Now, more than a third of the characters in this table are just these redundant percentage signs, so we should just remove them. And so we've now got a much simpler crosstab. What else can we do? Well, it's usually a good idea to merge together categories or to create nets. So for example, I might want to merge together like and love into a new category, which I'll call, going with the standard vernacular of market research, top two boxes. Even though they're at the bottom of the table, the top two, because they're the two most positive statements on the table. So I've got a combined group of them. We've made this a better table because usually people just want to know the top two box score. What else can we do? Before I had count data in every little cell, and that made the table too messy, but we can improve it by at the bottom of the table, putting column sample size. Some researchers have rules such as they'll only ever look at a column in a crosstab with a sample size of more than 30. And so if that's how we believed or wanted to operate, we would then want to merge this column with this column. Other researchers have a rule of 100. I personally don't find a lot of value in those rules. I like to look at statistical significance. So let's put the statistical significance on the table. And if I found that these two categories had no differences and one of the samples was small, I would merge them together, but I don't need to merge them here. I might merge some other things, like let's merge together, could potentially merge these two categories, or better off these guys. I'm going to create a category of people aged 25 to 39. Because I want to merge categories if they're reasonably small and there's not much of interest, because that means there's less numbers to look at. And I will go into that in more detail when we have a webinar next month on interpreting data and coming up with a story in the data. Let's just merge them. Okay, so that's the basics of creating a good crosstab that we can then go on and interpret. There are some other more advanced ways that people routinely customize crosstabs. Now, if you're really completely new to research, maybe just stick with what I've got, but if you want to get a little more advanced, this is how we start to do it. There are times we do want to add some statistics back onto a crosstab. For example, with this table here, I've got all this attitudinal data. It's often useful to look at an average for attitudinal data. So I'm going to add an average at the base of the table, which just becomes a shortcut way of comparing all of the data above. And so we can see here that the 18 to 24s have got the highest of the average attitudes, where a 5 was given as a score for love and a 1 for hate, and then the numbers in between for the in-between points. And we can see that the oldest age group has got the lowest average score. It can be useful to put conditional formatting on tables to emphasize things. I tend not to do it with a table of this size. I tend to do it with a much larger table. And the reason is I think people sometimes overinterpret them, but you can do it. It's sometimes useful to sort data. And here I've actually sorted with the highest numbers, the top to the bottom. And you can manually sort by dragging and dropping in Displayr. You can sort by clicking the little sort option, or you can use automated rules, which will automatically sort even when you filter the data, which is a little trickier, but it's what I've done here. It'll soon be much, much easier, though, you'll be happy to know. Another more complicated customization that a lot of people like to do is they like to add additional questions. Now, a bit of jargon here. A crosstab like this is sometimes called amongst, shall we say, more experienced researchers, by which really I mean older researchers, it's sometimes referred to as banners and stubs, where banners are the column points and the stubs are the row labels. Now, in that kind of jargon, you would say you want to put another question into the banner. And the way we do this, I'm going to drag gender across, and I'm going to hover over the banner and just release it so it's to the right of age. And I've got two questions in my table, age and gender. Now, I, in general, as a researcher, don't like to do this, I'll confess, because it makes the table bigger and harder for the brain. I like to just show one thing on a table at a time. But if you need to print a lot of tables out or you want to share them in big Excel spreadsheets, this can economize on space, which is sometimes useful to do. It really came about back when we printed all crosstabs, because my early crosstabs always came as printouts, and so we're trying to save paper, and this was kind of one of the tricks to doing that. Another more complicated way we can customize is to create a span, which is just a little subheading. So I'll group a couple of categories. I click create span and call it negative. So it's just a little category that appears across the top. It tends to be useful when you've got very large brand lists and you want to group them into product markets or something like that. Here we come to a more complicated problem. At first, this may look a lot like a crosstab. It's not actually a crosstab, though. It's a summary table of a grid question. The underlying data here showed people in the questionnaire six different brands and got people to rate how much they liked each of those brands. And this is the table you get. Now, this is a great table on its own, but where it gets problematic is if you want to crosstab it. Let's have a look at age. Now, having added age, I've ended up with this really wide table, which is very, very hard to process. I've also ended up with some percentages, which are a bit hard to understand because they're percentages within Coca-Cola, within the age. It just gets very confusing about what means what. And so the standard solution to that is you flatten the grid. And to make this a bit clearer, I'm just going to remove age from the table. And so you can see this is a grid at the moment, which has got six different columns. I'm going to go into the Insert, Transform, and choose Flatten. And what it's done is it's taken the six columns, it's turned them into one big column, which is kind of flattened, if you like. And the benefit of that is now if I want to cross-tab it by age, I can see the entirety of the analyses here. So I'm looking at the Coca-Cola data by age, and I can scroll down and see them all. And you might think, well, it's a similar size table to the one before, but it's actually much smaller in terms of scrolling and just tends to be a lot easier to analyze. So flattening questions is always a good idea when you're looking at grids. Now, stat tests, and before you recall that I put the stat test on the table, we do it to save time. Now, if you're worried about theory and you've got a theory, you've got a test, stat testing is kind of complicated to get your head around. But if all you're trying to do is hunt through lots of crosstabs, they save an enormous amount of time. Now, some of you have seen this example before, so apologies, it'll only take about 30 seconds. The question that we're trying to answer when we're hunting through the data, looking for the pattern, like a little, good little crosstab, kind of half dog, half pig here, isn't he? He's doing. Is where is Wally? Can you see Wally? Have a look. The reason we use stat testing is it helps us know where to look. A lot of people get a bit confused and think it's all scientific and you've got to believe stuff that it's stat test and understand all the theory. You actually don't, as long as you just remember this principle. It's just about helping you narrow down where to look. So stat testing, in this case here, it tells us we just need to look in these four spots. And if you look very carefully, you'll see that our good friend Wally is hiding in this middle group. How does this relate to doing market research? Here's a crosstab looking at attitude by how often people drink Coca-Cola. We've got some colors and arrows. So it's, some of these results are statistically significant, which means we do need to take the time to process them and work out whether that's interesting or not. And as I said, I will return to this in the next webinar that I do. Now let's look at the next table though. Here we're looking at attitude to Coca-Cola by how often people participate in competitions. And there is no arrows. I could try and interpret the data, but I don't need to. I can ignore it. It's irrelevant. I move on to the next table. Nothing significant. I can ignore it. It's irrelevant. And I would stress, if I don't have a theory, it's irrelevant. I don't. I'm just hunting through the data. And I can now start to save a lot of time because I've got quite a lot of these crosstabs. But rather than even read them all, I'm going to select them all. I'm going to go to this nice little utility call, delete tables if they're not significant. And Displayr reads through the report and just deleted a whole lot of tables. And so I've got much less work to do. Or if I'm really lazy, I can just send it off to my client now. I really appreciate you all joining the webinars today. I hope the rest of your day goes really well. Bye now.